Good afternoon. The first item of business today is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is health and social care. I would ask those members who would wish to request a supplementary question to please press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter R in the chat function during the relevant question. As ever, I would make a plea for succinct questions and answers to get in as many members as possible. Question number one, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to allocate any funding specifically for alcohol services in addition to that allocated to alcohol and drug partnerships for drug services.
Minister Marie Todd.
We are currently working in partnership with Simon Community Scotland to pilot and evaluate an innovative managed alcohol programme for people who experience homelessness. Funding allocated to alcohol and drug partnerships, ADPs, is for both alcohol and drug treatment services. In 2021-22, ADPs and health boards received over £106 million for alcohol and drug services, and that funding is used to ensure that the services meet the needs of people who experience alcohol as well as drug harms, including preventative approaches.
Miles Briggs.
I thank the Minister for that answer. While the Scottish Government has stated it recognises the twin public emergencies of drug deaths and alcohol harms, the Scottish Government stated earlier this month that it has no plans to introduce alcohol-specific treatment targets until 2024. Now, I think that's unacceptable. 2020, the number of people who tragically died because of alcohol increased by 17% to 1,190. So can I ask the Minister if the Scottish Government will now rethink that approach and introduce these specific treatment targets?
Minister.
So alcohol and drug-related harms are both important public health issues in Scotland, and that's why we established a national mission to improve and save lives. At the core of that national mission is ensuring that every individual is able to access the treatment and the recovery that they choose. We're working to ensure that people with alcohol use disorder continue to receive the same quality of care as those who experience problematic drug use. And the forthcoming alcohol treatment guidelines will provide support for alcohol treatment, similar to the medication-assisted treatment standards for drugs. We're also developing alcohol treatment targets alongside Stage 2 of the drugs targets implementation in 2024. So I am more than happy to hear from the member should he think there are things that we are not tackling in our approach to alcohol, but I am very comfortable with the work that we are doing and with the learning that we are gaining from the work being done in tackling our drugs challenges.
Question number two, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the support being made available to people with long COVID.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef, who is joining us remotely.
We are providing £3 million this year to NHS boards to help them respond flexibly to improve the care and support already available to people with long COVID. This investment will enable boards to introduce care coordinator roles, providing a single point of contact for people and their families to ensure they have access to the most appropriate care and support for them. It will also provide additional capacity for community rehabilitation to help people address issues affecting their day-to-day lives, including managing pain, fatigue, supporting a return to employment. We've also established a national strategic network for long COVID to ensure the continued development of our national approach is informed by evidence at the expertise, as well as those, of course, with lived experience.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. I've been assisting a constituent whose physical health has been so compromised by COVID that they are now wheelchair-bound and remain in hospital almost 1 year after admission. A council tenant has local authorities working with NHS colleagues as they try to secure a more suitable tenancy and resolve the debt that he's unintentionally accrued. But this is taking time, and the longer it takes, the longer he remains in hospital, essentially bed-blocking. So can I ask the Scottish Government how it's working with councils and health boards to ensure people have timely access to the health and social care support they need as they adjust to living with long COVID?
Cabinet Secretary.
Firstly, Presiding Officer, I'm very sorry to hear about Audrey Nicholl's constituent. That must be a very difficult experience for them and their wider family. And of course, I don't know all of the details of the constituent, but Audrey Nicholl is more than welcome to provide further details offline if she wishes. Of course, we work regularly with local authorities, with NHS health boards, and of course, crucially, health and social care partnerships right across the country, and we want them to be working in an integrated fashion to of course deal with and hopefully address the very issues that Audrey Nicol references here. We are putting considerable investment into delayed discharge. It is difficult in the social care sector, of course, with workforce being one of the most significant challenges, hence why we have, of course, in the course of the last 12 months, introduced two pay rises for adult social care workers. But there's more to do. Delayed discharges are far too high, and where health boards, local authorities and health and social care partnerships are not working closely together, then of course myself and of course the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care are more than happy to have the conversations with those relevant stakeholders.
Supplementary, Sandish Gohani.
Thank you. It's not just Audrey Nicol's constituent, 150,000 COVID sufferers. According to Professor Edward Duncan of the University of Stirling, many thousands of Scots of that 150 require treatment, but many remain unsupported. And it's believed that some health boards are reluctant to offer support for sufferers of long COVID for fearing they will be overwhelmed. Will the Cabinet Secretary commit today to establishing a network of long COVID clinics to coordinate support that long COVID sufferers are crying out for? And can he tell us if any of this year's 3 million tranche has been allocated and for what?
Cabinet Secretary.
So a couple of points, if I may. I did see the comments that Dr. Sandish Gohani references, and I thought some of the comments around signposting were well made, and therefore, of course, we are picking those points up with the relevant with health boards right up and down the country. I do not recognise his comments that health boards are reluctant to support people with long COVID. I would say that, and he will know this, of course, as a clinician, any clinician that I've met, is willing, not just willing, but of course very able to treat those with long COVID. So I don't detect any hesitancy from health boards or indeed clinicians to provide support for people with long COVID. As I mentioned, he will know in the debate that we had recently, the first tranche of that long COVID support fund has been allocated in terms of long COVID clinics. I will say what I've said to him previously. There's nothing stopping any health board, of course, right up and down the country from establishing a long COVID clinic if they think that is the best way to address long COVID, or indeed to provide support for those suffering from long COVID. And we'll leave those decisions for local health boards to come up with local tailored solutions for the health board area that they preside over.
And supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
There are 155,000 people in Scotland with long COVID, and the numbers are rising each and every month. The majority are simply not receiving services. The £3 million allocated by the Scottish Government is, of course, welcome, but it is a drop in the ocean. It works out at £19 per head in a given year. So given that the Scottish Government's response is 2 years late, it is inadequate given the scale of the task. Will the Cabinet Secretary commit to increasing the resources available this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'll look at any request to increase resources, but I think Ms Bailey's comments are misinformed. The suggestion that that is the only money that is being that is being invested to support those with long COVID is, of course, incorrect. Prior to the announcement of £3 million of that funding going for specific projects and health boards up and down the country, of course, health boards were already supporting people with long COVID. I accept her point that there are many people who are suffering from long COVID who feel they have not had the support that they require. There are also many people, and I have met a number of them, who tell me that if it wasn't for the support that they received, whether it was from physiotherapists, GPs, doctors, nurses, then they do not think that they would be alive today. Some have even said has been as strong in their opinions to me as that. So to suggest that the only money being spent to support people with long COVID is the £10 million announced would be incorrect. And of course, on her broader point of considering what further money can be invested, I will of course explore that.
Question number three, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I remind members of my register of interests to ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to reduce the 6,600 nursing and midwifery vacancies reported at the end of 2021.
Cabinet Secretary.
Nursing and midwifery staffing is at a record high. Staffing levels have increased by almost 15% under this government and by over 2% in the last year alone. Well, the nursing and midwifery vacancy rate is high. It has started to come down in the last quarter. Investing significantly in workforce expansion, as we have done, creates new vacancies in the short term, and we're now starting to see these posts being filled. To continue the downward trend, we'll invest a record £11 million to support further international recruitment, building upon recent successes, which will see Scotland welcoming almost 400 new nurses from overseas. We're also increasing domestic training too. Over the last 10 years, we have doubled the number of funded places for nursing and midwifery to a target intake in 2022-23 of 4,837.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer, but can I first and foremost pay tribute and thank all of the staff in our National Health Service? One of the reasons why NHS staff are, in the words of the Health Secretary, knackered, is because they are overworked. One of the reasons why the staff are overworked is because of the high level of vacancies I am raising with the Cabinet Secretary today. This is down to poor workforce planning, but it is also down to the undervaluation of NHS staff, including nurses and midwives. With inflation running at 9%, does the Cabinet Secretary seriously think that a real terms pay cut for nurses, for midwives and for other NHS staff of 4%, which he is offering NHS unions today, will cut it?
Cabinet Secretary.
We're offering 5% in terms of an increase, and I should say that is the largest single year increase in the history of devolution, including, of course, when his party was last in power, which I accept was many years ago. I should also say that since that time, we've increased staffing levels in the NHS by almost 30,000. We've seen increases in nursing and midwifery staff. And of course, staff, NHS staff in Scotland continue to be the best paid in the entire UK. It will now be, of course, for trade unions to take that deal away, consult with their members, of course, and I absolutely respect that right. The discussions and negotiations with our trade union colleagues have been very constructive, of course, at times robust and challenging, and I would expect no less from our trade union colleagues. But we have a process in place, an offer has been made, and I will leave it to trade union colleagues to then take that to their members to either accept, as I hope they will do, or indeed reject.
Supplementary, Fiona Hislop.
I have previously met with Minister Marie Todd and midwife representatives from Lothians in relation to the rollout of the Best Start 5-year plan for maternity and neonatal care, which includes continuity of carer, and NHS Lothian has agreed to meet me on this shortly. Can the Cabinet Secretary assure me that he is aware that midwifery vacancies may increase because of the way the Best Start programme is being rolled out? Many single parents, other working mothers and older midwives may not be able to operate on call 24/7, 5 days a week, and may not be contracted to do so and may leave the profession. Will he robustly question the pilot statistics as the results for mothers, babies and midwives of Lothian pilots is far from evident? And indeed, I understand the NHS Lanarkshire pilot was stopped.
Cabinet Secretary.
Fiona Hislop can be absolutely assured that myself and Marie Todd will, of course, robustly look at the data that is coming back from the projects in place. I should say, in terms of the rollout of continuity of care, it has restarted in all boards right across Scotland following the fact that it was paused due to the pandemic. As part of that remobilisation, as I say, we will gather data on the implementation of the model of continuity of carer. Models of continuity of carer involve the same midwife or small team of midwives providing care for a woman during and throughout her pregnancy, birth and indeed after birth, helping to build a continuous caring relationship between the woman and her midwife. I should say that the Best Start model does not and never has required midwives to work on call 24/7, 5 days a week, though I will explore and examine what Ms Hislop has said in her question. We expect all boards to develop models of continuity of midwifery care that are flexible, that are focused around women, but also work for staff, including those who work part-time and, of course, those that have other caring responsibilities.
Thank you. Before I call the next supplementary, could I just make a plea again for succinct questions and answers? I think the last few exchanges, both in terms of questions and answers, have been quite lengthy. I call by way of supplementary Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Across Scotland, one in four vacancies for nurses and midwives have been open for at least 3 months, and nearly 300 vacancies are left unfilled for more than 6 months after first being advertised. So beyond the Minister's usual empty rhetoric, what action is the SNP Government to taking long-term action to tackle those long-term and hard-to-fill vacancies in our NHS?
Cabinet Secretary.
It may be for Craig Hoy to dismiss facts as empty rhetoric, but I would say to the member that we have record levels of staffing within our NHS. Qualified nurses and midwives have increased on vacancies, and I take the points that have been made by members around retention. I have asked the Chief Nursing Officer to look into the issue of where we can provide, and the health boards can provide, greater levels of flexibility. I should say as well, as and I'm sure Mr Hoy is aware of this, in Scotland we have 8.5 qualified nurses and midwives per 1,000 of the population. That compares to 6.1 in England. That is not empty rhetoric. These are just, of course, the facts.
Question number four, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the cervical screening programme.
Minister Marie Todd.
The impacts of COVID-19 continue to pose challenges to the cervical screening programme. However, we're working closely with the organisations that oversee screening in Scotland to ensure that the programme remains on track and it's against its agreed recovery roadmap. The latest update data for the cervical screening programme for 21-22 is due to be published later this year. In recognition that the pandemic is likely to have exacerbated screening uptake inequalities, including for the cervical screening programme, we've committed over £2 million over 2 years to tackle this. In addition, we've awarded over £456,000 to Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust in support of cervical awareness campaign work that includes the Cervical Screening Awareness Week that's due to start from 20th of June.
Gillian Martin.
I thank the Minister for that update. I've been contacted by a couple of constituents who are facing longer waits for cervical screening results than normal, including one constituent who's been waiting for over 12 weeks, which really surprised me. If you go along for your cervical screening and you've never had any problems before, you usually forget about it. But if you've ever had problems before, you're waiting for that letter to arrive to tell you that you're clear. The Minister does know about this situation. I have written to her last week. Could she advise what work's been done to ensure that everyone gets their results in line with the targets set?
Minister.
The NHS is currently meeting the target for the average lab turnaround time for all samples, which is within 14 days. And in fact, over 80% of the participants in the programme received their results within a week of the sample being taken. I am aware of the particular case that you've raised on behalf of one of your constituents. Indeed, if there are more, I'm keen to hear about that, and I'm aware that my officials are looking into it.
Supplementary, Karen Mockin.
Mr. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's own Women's Health Plan accepts that women from higher socio-economic areas are more likely to take up cervical screening than those from the more deprived areas. Given we know that a clear way of bringing screening closer to home is by rolling out self-sampling, can the Minister outline any progress made in this regard, and what role will self-sampling play in the cervical screening programme in years to come if the Women's Health Plan target of reaching more people who may not ordinarily engage is to be met?
Minister.
So, whilst I agree with the member that self-sampling is certainly likely to help in terms of uptake, it's not the whole answer, and we can see that by looking at the bowel screening programme, which is done entirely at home but still doesn't have 100% participation. So we need to work more and we need to work clever. You'll be aware, the Chamber will be aware, that the home screening for cervical cancer is at an experimental stage. We're participating in piloting in Scotland, and we're very happy to do so. Those decisions will be made by the Four Nation National Screening Committee, and we are putting in place work in Scotland to ensure that if a decision is made to use home sampling, we are more than able to hit the ground running as soon as that decision is made. We are keen to do it. We are keen to do what we can. This is one of the most important things. Remember, with cervical screening, we have an opportunity to prevent cancer before it is even there.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. The effectiveness of the HPV vaccine should be acknowledged and praised, and the Minister will be aware of research showing that with the vaccine success, the screening programme strategy could change to focus resources Will this happen? And if so, does the Minister have a plan to communicate these changes to ensure high take-up for the continuing screening?
Minister.
So I thank the member for the question and I thank the member for her interest in this area. At the moment, actually, uptake is higher amongst those who have received the vaccine than those who have not received the vaccine. And we are very keen to continue at the moment with the twin strategy of vaccinating the eligible population and also using cervical screening to ensure that we detect cancer before it is even there. The member may or may not be aware that the World Health Organization has some work and some targets in place and is considering the possibility that cervical cancer could be eradicated. And of course, in Scotland, we are extremely interested in this work and would be keen to play our part in leading the way in the eradication of cervical cancer.
Question number five, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it considers it possible in the future for all residential care to be provided as a fully funded public service.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to thank Mr Coffey for writing to me on this important topic last month. As he will know, individuals assessed as needing personal and nursing care by their local authority and who reside in a care home will receive this care directly from the care home provider. For those self-funding their care home place, a payment contributing to these aspects of their care will be made directly to the respective care home by the local authority. The Feely Review considered whether it is appropriate for people to contribute to their accommodation costs in residential care or whether these should be free at the point of use. It concluded that it is reasonable for some charge to be made where the individual's means permit, because in other circumstances, that person would be paying accommodation costs at home.
Willie Coffey.
Minister, for that answer, you'll be aware of the huge cost of private residential care in Scotland that can run into thousands of pounds per week and often requires families to sell off their family home to pay for it. Does he think that we can look forward to a system in Scotland where families who have paid their dues throughout their working lives do not have to lose their life savings or their pensions or their homes in order to pay for that care, and that Scotland might move towards a publicly funded and delivered residential care service at some point?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as I pointed out, this was looked at in the independent review, and I've already stated what Derek Feely had to say. But we recognise that the cost of residential care can be high, and this is why we have increased the free personal and nursing care rates above inflation for the last two consecutive years to recognise the increasing costs. This is an increase in the rates of 18.3% since April of 2020, and we will continue to review these rates annually.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
I'm interested in bearing in mind what the Minister's just said, whether he can continue to claim that the new National Care Service will be like the National Health Service, which will be free. If we're continuing to charge for residential costs, how can it be justified to have the difference between those who are in hospital, who don't have to pay for the residential charges, and those who are in the National Care Service, who have to do so?
Minister.
Well, one of the reasons why it is different is because folks in hospital normally still have to pay for their accommodation costs while they are in hospital. And, you know, I have to say to the Chamber, you know, that I am open to discussions on lots of issues, but also I have to know from those folks that are advocating change where money is going to come from to pay for that change. And I have heard nothing from the opposition in that front in any of the budget debates or any of the budget discussions that have taken place in recent times.
Question number six, not lodged. Question number seven, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to reduce waiting times at accident and emergency departments.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Yousaf.
The COVID-19 pandemic continues to put pressure on hospitals and services. Despite this, more than two-thirds of patients are being seen in our A&E departments within 4-hour target. On the 1st of June, we launched our new urgent and unscheduled care collaborative for health boards, supported by £50 million, which will support the implementation of a range of measures to reduce A&E waiting times and improve patient experience. This includes offering alternatives to hospital, such as hospital at home, directing people to more appropriate urgent care settings, and scheduling urgent appointments to avoid long waits in A&E where clinically appropriate and safe to do so. This new approach will capitalise on the positive work already underway, such as discharge without delay, virtual capacity, and the redesign of urgent care.
Dean Lockhart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The most recent waiting times for Forth Valley Royal Hospital for accident and emergency and minor injuries show that over 500 patients waited more than 8 hours and 100 patients waited for more than 12 hours. And all of this despite staff working around the clock. The Cabinet Secretary has outlined additional finance, but what I'd like to know is what practical and urgent steps he will take to help Forth Valley, including additional recruitment of staff, to help Forth Valley Royal address these wholly unacceptable waiting times.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say I agree with Dean Lockhart. We have regular discussions with Forth Valley. The level of performance there is not acceptable, and the board and the management team at Forth Valley know that that is the case. They are, as Dean Lockhart rightly says, along with clinical staff, working around the clock and working hard to make improvements. In terms of what we can practically do, there's a whole range of initiatives that are underway, including in Forth Valley, and I'm happy to write to him in detail about that. But if I gave him one example, in the answer I just referenced the Hospital at Home programme, which we have recently increased our investment in that programme. Between September 2021 and February 2022, 4,500 people were treated by Hospital at Home services. They would have otherwise been admitted to hospital. That equates to over 26,000 bed days that have been saved. So there's a range of initiatives. In the interest of brevity, I'm happy to write to Dean Lockhart after this session with full details of all the interventions taking place and what we're doing to support, in particular, Forth Valley.
And supplementary, Mercedes Bialba.
Thank you. Can I remind members of my register of interest? Scottish ambulance service workers play a vital role in supporting the delivery of patient care in our A&E departments. But Unite the Union's recent survey of these workers revealed that they're increasingly understaffed, working longer shifts, facing greater abuse, and many are contemplating leaving the ambulance service altogether. So will the Scottish Government begin immediate negotiations with Unite the Union to explore formally recognising the ambulance service as an emergency service with workers employed on similar terms to those of the police and fire services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say I will continue my engagement with trade unions and have regular engagements with our trade unions representing all of those who work in the Scottish Ambulance Service. We, of course, last year had a record year of recruitment for staff at the Scottish Ambulance Service. On top of that, of course, one of the first acts I did as Health Secretary was to introduce the paramedic bursary, which is incredibly important for that future pipeline of Scottish Ambulance Service staff, and we continue to invest in Scottish Ambulance Service. But on Mercedes Villalba's specific point, I will take up further discussions with trade union colleagues.
And I can take question number 8 if I have succinct questions and answers. Question number 8, Finlay Carson.
Scottish Government, what support is providing to unpaid carers who are experiencing poor mental health?
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Presiding Officer, our National Wellbeing Hub includes specific resources to help unpaid carers look after their mental health. We have increased funding for breaks from caring as well as local carer support, including counselling and peer support. Our Mind to Mind wellbeing site links to lived experience videos and national resources directly relating to unpaid carers. We have also expanded local psychological services and therapies teams, which unpaid carers can access if they require bespoke help. And forthcoming standards for these services will include information about how carers should be supported as part of a whole systems approach using a stepped care model.
Finlay Carson.
For his response, evidence suggests that the pandemic has greatly exacerbated the poor mental health of carers. According to Carers Trust Scotland, 45% of young carers and 68% of young adult carers in Scotland stated that their mental health is worse due to coronavirus. Support in Mind's marginal ruralised communities report established that for young carers, money worries, care for relatives, feelings of isolation and stress greatly exacerbate poor mental health. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what targeted mental health support is being offered to unpaid carers, specifically in rural areas like my constituency of Galloway and West Dumfries?
Minister, briefly, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and we will continue to do all that we can for all of the population of Scotland in terms of ensuring that their mental wellbeing is best that they possibly can be. Mr Carson touched upon money worries. And I agree there are money worries, particularly with the Tory cost of living allowance. And carers here in Scotland, continuously in receipt of carers allowance, have received over £2,520 more than carers south of the border since 2018, thanks to our introduction of the carers allowance supplement that year. We will continue to urge Westminster to match our efforts and increase the level of support for unpaid carers, including ensuring that unpaid carers not on universal credit also benefit from the UK Government's cost of living payments.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the health and social care. Could we just have some quiet, please, whilst we're trying to conduct business? That concludes health and social care portfolios. We will now move on to the next portfolio, which is social justice, housing and local government. I'll allow a very brief pause to allow front bench teams to change position. Thank you. Thank you. The next portfolio is social justice, housing and local government. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press their request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letter R in the chat function. Again, I would make a plea for succinct questions and answers. And I call question number one, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy President. To ask the Scottish Government what action it's been taking to promote the creation of mid-market rental accommodation in Willowvians.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
The Government is determined to increase and accelerate the affordable housing supply across all tenures, including mid-market rent, and to support local authorities to deliver their strategic housing priorities. Mid-market rent housing is supported where it's identified as a strategic priority and meets a recognised need. And in the 4 years up to March 2021, 1,817 mid-market homes were completed in the Lothian area. In the current financial year, we expect 449 mid-market rented home approvals in the Lothian area, and around 200 further mid-market rent homes should be available through the mid-market rent invitation.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. Our capital is facing a crisis. LER Housing Trust is trying to address this by building and letting affordable mid-market rental properties. They work with a funding model that relies on loans from the government but get paid back in full with interest. Why won't the Scottish Government commit to supporting housing trusts like LAR that is not only helping to provide local affordable rental properties but also good for the public purse?
Minister.
Thank you. We certainly are aware of the work that's been done. This is a housing trust which pioneered the use of financial transaction loan money from the Scottish Government. And has delivered housing with that. And we've continued to work on that basis. Since 2016, we've provided £102.5 million of financial transaction loan funding, enabling private investment into the large-scale mid-market rent housing projects. But I would say again, as I said in my first answer, for a great many people, it's the wider affordable housing and social rented housing supply that is going to meet the critical need and be the most sustainable option for a great many people. And the Scottish Government is delivering on that at pace.
Supplementary, Co-Cab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The cost of living crisis is squeezing every household in Scotland, none more so than on low and moderate incomes. In these difficult times, does the Minister believe that mid-market rent can play an even greater role in the affordable housing supply programme, offering an alternative route for tenants?
Minister.
Well, yes, indeed. As I said in my answer to Mr Balfour, mid-market rent is one of a range of affordable tenures, and we are actively looking at how further innovative delivery mechanisms can provide much-needed affordable housing of all kinds and all tenures. We recognise, though, that social rented housing is the more affordable option for many. That's why we've committed to deliver 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, with 70% of those being for social rent. And that comes on top of the announcement yesterday that we've surpassed the target of 50,000 affordable homes delivered since the start of the last Parliament. It's worth saying that 9,757 affordable homes were delivered in the last financial year. That's the highest figure in a single financial year since 2000 to 2001. And the government will continue with this important work benefiting communities right across Scotland.
Question number two, Paul McLennan.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what information it holds on the level of need for accessible housing in Scotland.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Local authorities are responsible for assessing the housing needs in their areas and setting out in their local housing strategies how this will be met. This includes targets for wheelchair accessible housing across all tenures. Local authorities should make their local housing strategies available on their websites in the interest of transparency, and wherever possible, all affordable new build homes delivered as part of the Affordable Housing Supply Programme are built to housing for varying needs standards. And 95% of new build homes delivered by housing associations and councils in 2021, where information was returned, met that standard.
Paul McLennan.
Thank you. Can I thank the Minister for that answer? The new Scottish Accessible Home Standards is an important part of the Housing to 2040 strategy, building fairness and adaptability into Scotland's housing vision. Can the Minister tell me what she will do to ensure a culture of accessibility remains at the heart of her house building programme?
Minister.
Thank you very much. The Scottish Government is committed to delivering accessible homes that are fit for purpose now and for the future to meet the needs of older people, disabled people, wheelchair users and people with specific needs. We are currently reviewing the Housing for Varying Needs Design Guide, and this will help us inform the Scottish Accessible Homes Standard. Our guidance for local authorities when preparing local housing strategies makes clear that they must ensure specialist and accessible homes are central to their housing planning and delivery process locally. And this includes the setting of all tenure targets for the delivery of wheelchair accessible homes.
I have a number of supplementaries. I hope to take all of them. First from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Evidence shows that people with MND spend their final months fighting and waiting for adaptations to accessible homes, which are urgently needed. Can I ask the Minister what plans the government have to fast-track applications for adaptations to accessible housing for people with MND and other life-limiting conditions?
Minister.
Miles Briggs will not be surprised to know that I have personal interest in ensuring that people with MND live to the best standards they possibly can. And we are looking at, as I said in the previous answer, at reviewing the current housing adaptations system to make recommendations on how best to improve and streamline the system and to maximise the impact of those investments. And I think that's incredibly important that we are doing that piece of work, reviewing that, working with stakeholders in it, but also ensuring that, you know, we are fit for the future and fit for changing needs as well, and I think that's an important aspect here.
A supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for the answer so far. The Minister will, though, be aware that despite the strategies and the guidance, tens of thousands of disabled people are waiting on accessible homes and some of them are waiting years. So I'd like the Minister to set out whether or not she will commit to action to enforce, including possibly in legislation, the building of at least 10% accessible homes in every new development to reduce the huge length of time people are waiting just now.
Minister.
Can I thank Pam Duncan-Glancy for that question as well? And again, it comes down to the review that we are currently undertaking on housing needs and assessments. As I said, local authorities set these targets, but we are looking to have targets set across all tenures. As I said earlier, that standard and that process is 20 years old now. So, you know, I'm really looking forward to the review of that work being done, working with stakeholders, and I'm sure that Pam Duncan-Glancy has got great ideas that she can share with us in order to ensure that review is as targeted and as specific to the needs of people as possible.
And supplementary, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The North East has a significant number of military veterans, including disabled veterans, but does not have an adequate supply of accessible housing. I thank the Minister for the details she has already provided in previous answers, but can I ask what steps we can take to ensure that there is accessible social housing proportionate to the needs of the whole community, particularly veterans in geographical hotspots?
Minister.
Thanks very much for that question as well. Funding is available through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme to deliver accessible homes, including homes specifically for veterans, where local authorities identify this as a strategic need. Since 2012, over £6 million has been made available through the programme to deliver over 100 homes for veterans. And in preparing their local housing strategies, local authorities must demonstrate that they have considered all housing needs, including that of armed forces communities, and that engagement has taken place with relevant organisations such as Veterans Scotland.
Question number three, Sandish Gohani.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to allow people who are seeking treatment for addiction to retain their tenancies through continued housing payments.
Minister Ben McPherson.
Under current UK legislation, housing benefit or the housing element of universal credit are reserved benefits and cannot be used to support both a tenancy and residential rehabilitation. Therefore, the Drugs Policy Minister introduced the Dual Housing Support Fund last year to cover full tenancy costs while someone is in residential rehabilitation, to ensure that no one has to make the impossible choice between accessing residential rehab and keeping their home. The Scottish Government Dual Housing Support Fund is part of the £5 million per year recovery fund, which supports individuals to access residential rehabilitation.
Sandish Gohani.
Thank you. I'm glad the Minister spoke of the Dual Housing Support Fund. It helps people with drug and alcohol dependencies to not give up housing, and it came in May 2021. But over a year later, there is very little information on the scheme, and implementation appears to have stalled. Can the Minister tell us how many people are in receipt of this fund? And does he think it is right that some people are still having to choose between their health or their home?
Minister.
I thank Dr. Gohani for his follow-up question, and indeed I'm sure he'll be interested in engaging with the Minister for Drugs Policy in making the case to the UK Government for changes to reserve benefits to help in this regard. To answer his question directly, the Dual Housing Support Fund has not stalled. It has been working and helping people. There have been several referrals to date for the fund, which have all been successful, and there have been five people who have been supported through the fund so far. If Mr. Gohani wants to see more support for people in these situations, I would encourage him to engage with his UK colleagues on housing benefit and the housing element of universal credit so that these can be used to support both a tenancy and residential rehabilitation, as well as the additional support that, of course, I've mentioned that the Scottish Government is providing.
Question number four, Colin Beasy.
To ask the Scottish Government what impact the reported labour shortages and significant cost increases on materials will have on social housing construction in Scotland.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. We are, of course, aware of the global issues affecting construction, which are impacting affordable housing delivery. We're working with the construction industry and housing partners to mitigate this wherever possible, and we operate a flexible grant system which can take account of increased costs. Despite these challenges and those caused by the global pandemic over recent years, including the necessary lockdowns, as I mentioned earlier, the Scottish Government has delivered 111,750 affordable homes since 2007, 78,000 of those for social rent, and we've passed the target of 50,000 affordable homes, starting on the delivery of an ambitious plan for a further 110,000 affordable homes by 2032.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Minister for his response. Can the Minister elaborate on what modern methods of construction are being considered by developers and by the Scottish Government to meet our affordable housing targets?
Minister.
Yes, indeed, there's a great deal of work with the sector examining the potential for modern methods of construction. We already deliver homes using off-site construction methods, predominantly timber frame, and we'll continue to support proven approaches. Given the real potential for benefits to housing delivery, tenants and to the environment, we are currently considering how we can increase uptake and investment in off-site construction to support the delivery of more efficient, high-quality and net-zero affordable homes in the future.
And supplementary, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Social housing construction obviously depends on approval numbers, and the number of affordable home approvals have dropped significantly in the recent statistics published, around 7,800 in 21-22 compared to 12,800 in the previous year, never dropping before below 10,000 up until the year 2016. Can the Minister say what is the reason for the drop in approvals and how the Scottish Government can get that pipeline of affordable home delivery back up to the level we've previously seen.
Minister.
Well, as I've now had, I think, three opportunities in over the course of two questions to remind the whole chamber, we have just this week announced the successful completion. We've surpassed the target of 50,000 homes delivered since the start of the last Parliament. And we're already making progress on the delivery of a longer term and even more ambitious target of 110,000 by 2032. And the number that I mentioned, 9,000, I think, in the previous answer, was the most significant impact of any financial year to date. So we're making significant progress, and I think that contrasts very sharply with the approach of the UK government, which is currently contemplating rebooting the desperately damaging right to buy policy, which this government prevented from going forward in Scotland. And we've got no intention of repeating the mistakes that the UK government looks about to repeat.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
What's the Scottish Government doing to address the skills shortage in the construction industry in the islands, which is impacting much-needed social housing projects that have been in the pipeline for years?
Minister.
Yes, indeed. There's, as the member knows, a significant amount of work, not only on the skills and supply chain for new build, but also for the retrofit, which is also a particular challenge in many island communities. We're working very closely with the sector to address those challenges, and I'm sure there'll be much more to update the member on as we develop the supply chain delivery plan later this year.
Question number five, Graeme Day, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it's prioritising the national mission to tackle child poverty.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Our second delivery plan, Best Start Bright Future, sets out our actions to tackle child poverty, including our focus on long-term parental employment support, increased social security and measures to reduce household costs. The resource spending review allocates up to £300 million for tackling child poverty and social justice. It also commits more than £23 billion through social security payments in the next 4 years, with almost £1.8 billion for the Scottish child payment, which will increase to £25 per child per week when the payment is extended to under 16s at the end of 2022.
Graeme Day.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Scottish Government's plans to mitigate the impacts of the cost of living crisis are as welcome as they are necessary, especially where they seek to tackle child poverty. But these stand in marked contrast to those of the UK Government. Can I ask if any assessment has been done on how many children could be lifted out of poverty by 2023-24 if the UK Government found a moral compass and matched the support the Scottish Government is delivering through the spending review?
Minister.
Scottish Government analysis recently set out that if key UK Government welfare reforms implemented since 2015 were reversed, an additional £780 million would be put in the pockets of Scottish households in 2023-24, lifting 70,000 people out of poverty, including 30,000 children. By doing that, it would be part of a concrete long-term action that is needed to address poverty. Other actions could be to match the Scottish Government action, including uprating benefits and introducing the equivalent of the Scottish Child Payment. We know UK ministers do not prioritise tackling child poverty, which is why this Parliament should have the full powers over social security and employment so that we can take the action which is needed.
A supplementary, Mercedes Bialba.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been estimated that around 30,000 children in Scotland are in poverty as a direct result of the cost of privately rented housing. In response to my calls for immediate action to freeze rent at stage two of the COVID recovery bill last week, the Deputy First Minister said, and I quote, "Obviously, the government will look to take whatever action we can in the short term. So will the Scottish Government commit today to work with me ahead of stage three of the bill to strengthen amendments for an emergency rent freeze?"
Minister.
Thanks very much for Mercedes Villalba for bringing that up. I'm reliably informed by my colleagues that a meeting has been offered to talk about the very subject that she's raised in her question, and I would hope that she would take up that offer and address it at that point.
Question number six, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government how it will align its priorities for local government services with future projects by local authorities that are funded through the UK Government's Shared Prosperity Fund.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
We have maintained that the replacement of the EU funding through the UK Shared Prosperity Fund ought to be devolved to the Scottish Government and this Parliament to guarantee that investment best supports our national economic priorities. As the UK Government has chosen to bypass the Scottish Government in delivering the fund, it is difficult to ensure alignment with Scotland's national strategy for economic transition. Despite this, we will continue to work in partnership with our local authorities to make sure that all resources deliver the greatest benefit for Scotland.
Michelle Thompson.
Given that the UK Government plans yet another fund intended to bypass the Scottish Government, and despite Westminster Public Accounts Committee noting in a recent report that the UK Government does not yet have a strong understanding of what delivers local growth, will the Minister consider legislation or perhaps even guidance aimed at ensuring Scottish local authorities must take account of Scottish priorities when bidding for such funds?
Minister Richard Lockhead.
I thank the member. I noticed how the Conservative benches sighed when the member even pointed out that one of the Westminster committees supports some of the concerns of the Scottish Government. We have no plans to legislate at this stage with Scottish local authorities because they've got their own powers, responsibilities and financial freedom to operate independently, so it wouldn't be appropriate for the Scottish Government to do that. But saying that, we are very clear that we want to use the regional economic partnerships as well as discussions with local government to see where we can ensure that public investment is aligned with national priorities. And it's a very important example the member, or Michelle Thompson, highlights, illustrating why the Shared Prosperity Fund should have been devolved to this Parliament, given we were promised that Brexit would strengthen Scottish devolution and that European funding would be matched, whereas instead there's a massive shortfall and this Parliament's been bypassed.
Question number 7, David Torrens.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what actions are being taken to ensure the success and viability of Scotland's affordable housing supply programme.
Minister Ben McPherson.
More than £3.6 billion in funding is being made available this parliamentary term to support the delivery of affordable homes, continuing the vital and ambitious work we started in 2007, which, as was said earlier, has seen over 111,000 affordable homes delivered. We continue to work closely with our housing partners, who are critical to delivery, and have provided five-year resource planning assumptions to give them the certainty to plan ahead and to ensure progress towards our commitment to deliver 110,000 more affordable homes by 2032, with 70% for social rent and 10% in remote rural and island areas.
David Torrens.
Challenges clearly exist in reaching the 110,000 affordable home target. It is important to celebrate the precedent set Scotland has already set. Does the Minister welcome, as I do, the fact that researchers in Australia recently called for Scotland to be used as a model for effective affordable house building? And can he illustrate how the Scottish Government and partners will build on this international recognition?
Minister.
We absolutely welcome this international recognition, which acknowledges the focus and priority the Scottish Government place on ensuring that everyone has a warm, safe, energy-efficient and affordable home. We will continue to work in partnership to build on our strong record delivering affordable homes as part of our long-term Housing to 2040 strategy, a strategy which clearly recognises the vital role that housing plays in tackling poverty and inequality, creating and supporting jobs, meeting our energy efficiency and fuel poverty targets, and tackling the climate emergency, ensuring that we have connected, cohesive communities to live in. And this international recognition is something that we should all be proud of and look to build on.
Question number 8, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met COSLA.
Minister Ben McPherson.
The Scottish Government engages regularly with COSLA representatives to discuss a wide range of issues as part of our shared commitment to working in partnership with local government to improve outcomes for the people and communities of Scotland. I had my last monthly relationship meeting with the COSLA presidential team on the 31st of May, and alongside other ministerial colleagues, we'll be meeting the new COSLA presidential team soon, following their election this coming Friday on the 17th of June.
Thank you. COSLA is well aware of the financial constraints that the SNP Government has imposed upon them. And despite allocating £20 million to preparations for a second independence referendum, the SNP will slash council budgets by 6.3% in real terms, which means a cut of £11 million in East Lothian by 2025-2026. Why doesn't the SNP Green Government just give it a rest and commit that £20 million to council services rather than wasting it on their constitutional obsession?
Minister.
As has been pointed out in this chamber yesterday, of course, we have an obligation to the people of Scotland to fulfil the democratic duty on which we were elected on.
Yeah.
And I would just refer Craig Hoy to the very poor record on local government funding that his party has in other parts of the UK.
Yeah.
Of course, overall funding...
Excuse me, Minister, please resume your seat. Please don't shout across the chamber whilst you're seated. Thank you. Minister, please continue.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And of course, overall funding for the Scottish Government, as has been said in this chamber before also, has been cut by 5.2% in real terms since last year. But in 22-23, we increased the total package of local government funding to £12.7 billion, at a real terms increase of 6.3%.
And I have three supplementaries. I would hope to take all three, if we can be reasonably brief. First, from Bill Kidd, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The local council elections last month are a chance to refresh and renew democratic connections between the Scottish Government and local authorities. Is the Minister hopeful that the Scottish Government and COSLA can work positively side by side to address the major challenges our communities are facing, such as the cost of living crisis and the impacts felt from the war in Ukraine?
Yeah. Minister.
I think Bill Kidd makes extremely important points, and indeed I have discussed this on several occasions with the COSLA presidential team, because we in the Scottish Government absolutely recognise and value the really important and unique role that councils play in the daily lives of the people of Scotland, and it is therefore vital that we can continue to work in partnership with local government as different spheres of government through COSLA and directly with local authorities, not only to jointly tackle the challenges that Bill Kidd rightly highlights, but also to be ambitious and share ideas about progressing our mutual aims and priorities. So we are absolutely unequivocal about working with local government collaboratively and collectively, and that the people of Scotland are best served when national and local government work together.
Supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
Can I ask the Minister what discussions there have been with COSLA about increasing the mileage allowance for social care staff, particularly those in the private sector, as fuel prices rise to £2 a litre? The Scottish Government can intervene because they already top up the salaries of care staff in the private sector. The First Minister promised action 6 weeks ago. Could I ask the Minister what has happened since, and when will care workers get an increase in their mileage allowance?
Minister.
These are important issues that Jackie Bailey raises. I mentioned in a previous answer that ministers engage with COSLA in terms of different portfolios as well as through the local government brief. And this, of course, is something that health and social care ministers engage with the health and social care lead for COSLA on. And I'm sure the new appointee to that position for COSLA will engage with relevant ministers on that point as soon as their elections take place on Friday.
And supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister confirm that even if there is a real terms reduction to local authority budgets over the 4 years of the resource spending review due to cuts imposed on this Parliament by the UK Government, it will still not in any way match the deep cuts imposed on local government in England already by Mr Hoy's Tory colleagues, and that £20 million for an independence referendum in no way matches £4 billion of PPE being burned by the UK Government, a government that really knows how to waste public money?
Minister, please extract the relevant bits for your portfolio.
I think, as he has done on several occasions before, Mr Gibson rightly, wisely and quite rightly, passionately emphasises the extremely poor record of the Conservative Party when it comes to local government finance and also on financial management more generally. The outcome of our resource spending review means that we have, despite the most challenging of circumstances, protected local government revenue budget in cash terms, with an additional £100 million being added in 26-27. And while local government funding is not wholly comparable, we have delivered a 3.6% cash terms revenue budget increase to Scotland's councils between 2013 and 2020, when over the same period in English local authorities, they faced a cash terms revenue budget cut of 14.7%.
Yeah.
I think the figures speak for themselves, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice, housing and local government. And there will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.